This is the Lu Xun Museum. Came here a week or two ago. It was Monday, they were closed. It was on Mid-Autumn Festival. So most things were closed. It's now a public holiday for the last several years. Let's see. Museum. Here's some English. Agnes Smedley, she was a friend of Lu Xun. Born a poor worker's family, state of Missouri. Arrived in China in 1928. Became acquainted with Sun Qingling, Lu Xun, and other progressive personages in Shanghai, and took a part in the left-wing culture movement. I learned about that on Dulin Culture Street, famous celebrity street. Dulin Celebrity Culture Street, something like that, in Shanghai, where they would meet. Traveled extensively all over the country after arrival in Yinan, 1937. Reporting on Chinese People's War resistance against Japanese aggression, both at the front and rural areas behind enemy lines, at the same time devoted great efforts to organizing international aid to help the Chinese people's resistance to war. Resistance war. Prolific writer, among her published works were Battle Hymn of China, The Great Road, Life and Times of Chu Te. In these works, she eulogized the great Chinese people's revolution and war resistance. She also wrote an autobiographical novel entitled Daughter of the Earth. Agnes Smedley lived and worked in China for nearly 12 years. She died in London, 1950, according to her will. Chinese people buried her ashes in Beijing's Babaoshan Cemetery. I was out at Babaoshan yesterday. I went to the International Sculpture Park at the metro stop off Line 1. Comrade Xu Te inscribed her tombstone. So she was a patriot, huh? They were trying to say something to me when I first walked in. I don't know, understand if the museum is open or closed or what. Because I don't see much going on now. Maybe I can walk over this way. So it looks like whatever was in this hall is now closed. Here we go. Second part of the exhibit is upstairs. Now we are here. Lu Xun. Lu Xun is a famous for the books Medicine, Diary of a Madman. It's the story of O. Or is that the character in Diary of a Madman? He railed against the He railed against the Confucian imperial education system. So they're showing a Shaoxing, where Lu Xun was born. His pen name was Zhou Shuren. Family land owning scholar gentry, river town Zhejiang province. Shaoxing's between Hangzhou and Ningbo. It's known for its sherry wine. There's a lot of restaurants around here, I think. There's a Lonely Planet mentioned a restaurant from one of the characters in his novels who's a drunk that serves up a lot of drunken chicken, stuff like that, drowned in wine. His grandfather attained Jinshi, a metropolitan degree, and was admitted to the Imperial Hanlin Academy of Beijing, great distinction for a scholar during the Qing era. Lu Xun began his study of the Confucian classics aged 12 years old in a private schoolhouse known as the Three Flowers, Three Flavors Studio.
When he was 13, his grandfather was arrested for his involvement in a scandal over the administration of the civil service exams. Then his father became seriously ill. The young Liu Zhen often had to go from pawn shop to go from a pawn shop where he sold the family's possessions to a medicine shop to purchase the expensive but ineffective remedies prescribed by a traditional practitioner. Regarding this period, he later wrote, "Anyone who has come down in the world will come in process to see the true face of society." This is what I was saying yesterday at the Capitol Museum, that the Confucian system was great if you're the upper 1% of people who can afford to be educated and become literate, sit around reading these ancient Confucian classic texts. There are five main Confucian classic texts. It's like taking the SATs today. You can prep, do well. Yeah, oh great, get into a good college. Like, you know, it's a paper chase, essentially. And the Confucian ideals, at their very core, are well-meaning. But by this time, it had become such a corrupt way of keeping the status quo. And the peasants, you know, had no hope of rising up if they, you know, had to work the fields and were illiterate, so. And you had serious mismanagement during this time. So, even the people who were in charge weren't doing a very good job. China was semi-feudal and semi-colonial by this time. It was obvious that the Qing government was powerless to do anything to resist the imperial colonizers who were slicing China up like a pizza. And so, unfortunately, well, maybe fortunately for the peasants in the long run, it'd be another 100 years from the 1850s to 1950s, you know, for China to really emerge as a modern nation. And even then, it's not till now in the 90s that you get first world development and big cities, but that creates its own problems, such as look at the Beijing has such good air quality, because you can obviously see if you look at this. I mean, look at that. It's pure white. White is the driven snow. The part against my face is pure white, and the part that I breathe in through is pure white as well. There's no delineation at all between the two. There's no particulate matter trapped in this mask that would otherwise be in my lungs. I probably wear this about half the time for the last 2 weeks that I've been in Beijing. Less than half the time that I've been outdoors. So as you can see, it's wonderful to live in a big city. Mega city of 20 million plus people. I wish there were more of these mega cities in the world. It's a good idea. The great Yu's tomb, legend says that great Yu of the Xia dynasty who tamed China's rivers was buried here. Liu Zhen's story curbing the flood was based on this legend. Platform of the king of Yue, Gu Jian, who reigned in this area during the spring and autumn period. Orchid Pavilion, where the famous calligrapher Wang Shiji wrote preface in the poems composed at the Orchard Pavilion. And it's really hard sometimes to learn Chinese like this, not formally, because you'll see mistakes in the spelling. They didn't put the E on the end of the U there, so I was like, I thought it was Yue, you know? Or like, I'll look at a map today, instead of G for street, J-I-E, they had G-I-E, and I was like, huh? You know, on my little Galileo map. And you'll just see stuff like that all the time, and it can really throw you off when you're first trying to learn. Old family compound, Zhou clan, house of land owning scholar gentry during the Qing. Liu Shan's grandfather, grandmother, and step-grandmother. Liu Shan's grandfather was admitted to the Imperial Hanlin Academy in Beijing. As custom, this tablet was placed over the gate of his home. A portrait of Liu Zhen's father, Zhou Boyi. Liu Zhen's mom, La Rui, hailed from Anqiao Tu, nearby river village. Constant abominations of the family, written by his grandfather and hand copied by Liu Shun. collected poems, Tonghua Pavilion, and anthology of Lu Xun's grandfather, hand copied by Lu Xun. The birthplace of Lu Xun. The room where Lu Xun was born, September 25th, 1881. His original name was Zhou Shangshu, cognomen Yukai. Later he adopted the name Zhou Shuren. Lu Xun was his pen name. A rhymed partner, a rhymed primer in Chinese history. Lu Xun's first textbook on entering primary school at age 7. Letter written by Lu Xun's grandfather recommending a method for studying the classics to his grandson. Quintessence of poetry, a Tang and Song dynasties. Lu Xun's grandfather sent this book to his grandsons from Beijing. Manuscript of the 24 illustrations of filial piety written by Lu Xun. 24 illustrations of filial piety. Mouse Gets Married, one of Lu Xun's favorite pictures, posted above his bed in childhood. One of Lu Xun's, you know, I know why people cough all the time now in Beijing. If you're here for 3 days, you're not going to figure it out. You spend 2 weeks here breathing in this air, you'll figure it out. You'll figure it out real good. One of Lu Xun's favorite books in his childhood, an illustrated edition of the Book of Mountains and Seas, an imaginative treatment of lands beyond China, sometimes depicted as exotic places, people by weird creatures, including the Headless Man. A small courtyard with a sweet osmanthus tree where Lu Xun's grandmother told him stories. The kitchen of Zhou House, where Lu Xun first met Zhang Yunshui, who was the prototype of the character Run Tu in Lu Xun's story, My Old Home. Shallow basket which could be used to catch birds in snow is described in My Old Home. Dog teaser used by poultry keepers in Shaoxing. Hens can stretch their necks in to eat, but dogs can only look on furiously, as described in My Old Home. Mirror of Flowers, one of many books read by the young Lu Xun, who is fond of growing plants and flowers. 100 Plant Garden is the name of the courtyard behind the Zhou family compound. Three Flavors Studio, private school where Lu Xun studied from 12 years old. Mr. Xu Jingwu, Lu Xun's teacher in private school, who had attained the degree of Shui Kai Le Sentiat. An Chiao Tu, home village of Lu Xun's mom. Lu Xun was interested in and much influenced by Shaoxing local opera. These are manuscripts of his essays concerning them, and a drawing of Huo Wu Chang, a folk Buddhist version of the Grim Reaper, drawn by Lu Xun. Shaoxing Street in Beijing, in Shanghai, has a little cafe called the Viennese Cafe. Across from it's kind of a park, and they mention Shaoxing opera and other local operas. You have to remember that Peking opera is only a modern creation from like the Qing Qianlong era, I think, essentially. There was lots of little different variations in the provinces of traditional music, theatrical music. Riverside Open Air Theater Stage in Zhouzhuang Village. Zhouzhuang. I've been to Zhouzhuang. It's one of the water towns outside Shanghai. As a boy, Lu Xun watched opera staged outside the temple at night here from a boat. When his grandfather was in prison, Lu Xun and his younger brother, Zhou Juren, were forced to flee to the home of relatives. I was often called a beggar, as he recalls later. For more than 4 years, Lu Xun went almost every day to the pawn shop to sell his family's personal items. and to get drugs to and to drugstores to buy medicines for his father.
Ancient Chinese method. Some government files concerning the corporation case of Zhou Fuqing, Lu Shun's grandfather.
Contract indicating that Lu Shun's father had borrowed money. A list of books Lu Shun planned to purchase in his own handwriting. Many of the books were new books published by Dian Shi Jai Publishing House in Shanghai. Some books on paintings Lu Shun purchased. Report in the newspaper New Knowledge indicated that the imperial powers plan to carve up China. There's a better political cartoon with the British bulldog, an American eagle, Russian bear, Japanese rising sun, French frog. Popular histories read by Lu Shun, which helped him learn the unofficial versions of Chinese history. An Ode to Plums, a poem written by Tong Yue, hand copied by Lu Shun. Confucian classics read by Lu Shun. These books were the foundation of the traditional imperial examination system. Parting from My Brothers, three poems by Lu Shun, expressing an exhortation to his younger brothers to apply themselves to their studies. This is a typical water town. So you got the front canal here, laid out with all these courtyard homes, Sihehyuan, quadrangle courtyard homes, central garden in the middle there, the complex. I've been to several of the water towns around Shanghai. They're all more or less the same, but each one has one or two unique things that you won't see anywhere else. They're telling me to go around this way, huh? In Nanjing, 1898 to 1902. I think the lines on the floor are going backwards. 1898, Lu Shun left Shaoxing for Nanjing to begin the study of modern engineering and science, and finally entered the School of Mines and Railroads, free of tuition, where he'd received a scholarship 4 years later. During this period, he was much taken with new books such as Huxley's Evolution and Ethics, which proved a critical introduction to social Darwinism. He did this reading in the wake of China's defeat by Japan in 1894-5, and the suppression by conservative Empress Dowager of the Hundred Days Reform, backed by the young Guangxu Emperor and his progressive advisors such as Kong Yue, and Liang Shi Chao. This heightened Lu Zhan's concern for China's fate in a world of competing imperial powers. Both China and Russia got their ass handed to them by the Japanese in naval wars. 1894-5, I guess, is China, and then 1904-5 for Russia. Supposedly, the Empress Dowager took the money that China was going to modernize its navy with and built a stone boat in the old summer palace. It's like, you know, the kind of mismanagement we were talking about earlier. Meanwhile, Japan, initially had resisted foreign interaction and trade, just like the Qing government did. But they very quickly reversed course and went gung-ho for military industrial complex, Meiji Restoration, and get rid of the feudal system. And within a generation, Japan's a major world power, the world power of Asia, and they almost succeed by World War II in becoming a colonial power. (Clears throat) In 1898, Liu Shun was enrolled in the Jiangnan Naval Academy at Nanjing. Jiangnan is a name for the Yangtze in Putonghua, or is it Chang? Jiang. Student Hostel, Naval Academy. Disappointment in the way the Naval Academy was run. Liu Shun transferred to the School of Mines and Railways in the same city. The Qinglongshan coal mine outside Nanjing, where Liu Shun on a field trip learned about the harsh lives of miners. Some of the textbooks Liu Shun used at the School of Mines and Railways with his notes and handwriting. Geometry and other textbooks of Liu Shun used in Nanjing. Hand copied textbooks Liu Shun used in Nanjing. Books and journals Liu Shun read when he was studying in Nanjing. Nanjing. Kang Yuwei, Liang Qichao, Tan Shang. June 1898, the Emperor Guangxu ordered King Yuwei, Liang Qichao, Tan Zitong, etc. to carry out reform policy, but this was suppressed in September the same year by the conservative Empress Dowager. She held the reins of power until she died, and Puyi had his short reign at the end of the Qing. She's really the reason for the fall of the Qing, because she refused to modernize and reform. Charles Darwin, British biologist, author Origin of the Species, T.H. Huxley, British writer, wrote Evolution and Ethics to critique social Darwinism. Yan Fu, famous translator of Evolution and Ethics. Su Hao, daily newspaper published in Shanghai advocating anti-Qing revolution. Some poems Liu Shun wrote in Nanjing recorded in Zhou Ju Ren's diary. Liu Shun called himself the warrior student. This is the seal bearing these characters. Chameleon, translated by Lin Shu. Liu Shun bought about 30 translations by Lin Shu in this period. Lin Shu, famous in literary circles at the time, translated as many as 170 Western works of fiction in a classical style Chinese. In 1900, the armies of the eight powered allied forces invaded China to suppress the Boxer Uprising. The next year, the Qing government signed a large indemnity. So, just like in the Opium Wars, they're again forced to pay an indemnity for trying to assert their national sovereignty to the foreign powers. Liu Shun graduated from the School of Mines and Railways, ranked the third among all students, and got the diploma. An inscription, Liu Shun, on travel diaries by Xu Xiaqi, which he had rebound. Travel diaries by Xu Xiaqi. Xu Xiaqi. Xiaqi. Xu Xiaqi. Purchased 1898 by Liu Shun. In Japan, 1902 to 1909, this is where he gets his education, just like in modernization and reform, just like Sun Yat-sen, Zhongshan. March 1902, Liu Shun left for Japan on a Chinese government scholarship. For the first 2 years, he studied Japanese in preparatory courses. Among the burgeoning overseas Chinese student community, he was exposed to anti-Manchu revolutionary tracts. There he eventually cut off his queue, which was a symbol of national oppression. During this period, Liu Shun published translation of science fiction and wrote articles on geology and mineralogy. 1904, Liu Shun went to Sendai Medical Academy under the tutorship of Mr. Fujino and other professors, but in the next year, saw a slideshow in class about the Russo-Japanese War, in which a Chinese man was about to be beheaded by Japanese troops for serving as a scout for the Russians, while a group of Chinese looked on, taking in the scene as a spectacle. This made him realize that China's ailments were spiritual rather than physical, and so he decided to abandon medicine for a career in literature. Returning to Tokyo, he attempted to launch an abortive literary journal titled Vita Nova, New Life. 1907-80, he published a series of articles on history of science, literature, and philosophy. He translated foreign literatures, especially that of Eastern Europe and Russia. In 1909, he and his brother, Jojo Ren, had 2 volumes of short stories published. So, there's a lot of anti-foreign stuff going on in Japan in the end of the Meiji era. When does the Showa start? Showa period? Yeah, I get a little confused now. It's been several months since I left Tokyo. Liu Shan practiced judo when he studied at the Koban Institute. I went to a judo museum over by the theme park in Tokyo there, where the baseball games are played there. Liu Shan inscribed a poem on his photo taken after he had his queue cut off. They had to cut the hair of the samurai, you know, at the start of the Meiji. That was like the sign too, right there. The long hair, the samurai, the symbol to his obedience to the shogun. Sun Yat-sen, they have a queue in the museum at Sun Yat-sen's residence in Shanghai of an actual queue that was cut off the ponytail at the back of the head. And Sun Yat-sen recommended everyone cut their queue off after the 1912 revolution. In March of 1902, Liu Shan went to study in Japan, government scholarship, attended Koban Institute Preparatory School for Chinese Students, teaching mostly Japanese language. Some books and journals published by Chinese students in Japan. Liu Shan had several essays published in Zhejiang Tide, a journal edited by students from Zhejiang Province. Victor Hugo, French writer. Marie Curie, French physicist, chemist, native of Poland. I don't know if Madame Curie was from Poland. A photo taken for an assembly of students from Zhejiang Province, the 14th. Left in fourth row is Liu Shan. Fellow students from Shaoxing. Left of the back row is Xu Shushang, lifetime friend of Liu Shan. Sketch by French writer Victor Hugo, first foreign literary work in Liu Shan translated. That work Liu Shan translated into Chinese from a Japanese version, published in the 5th issue of Zhejiang Tide. Sounds like transliteration, huh? French, Japanese, Chinese. Liu Shan compiled and published a historical novel adapted from foreign sources, The Soul of Sparta, praising a self-sacrificing spirit of ancient Spartan resistance against the invading Persians at Thermopylae. On Radium, an essay written by Liu Shan relating the discovery of Radium by Marie Curie. Jules Verne, French science fiction writer, forward to the Annals of Chinese Minds, written by Mai Liang, once the consul with the Chinese embassy in Japan. Photo taken when he graduated from Koban Institute in 1904. Translated names of ores in Liu Shan's handwriting. Manuscripts, geological papers, Liu Shan's handwriting. Diploma issued by Koban Institute. Annals of Chinese Mines with a map of Chinese mines attached, jointly compiled by Liu Shan and Gu Lang, published 1906. Qing government ordered mining and business circle in China to read it and listed it as a reference book for middle school. An outline of Chinese geology published 1906 contained one of the earliest systematic treaties of Chinese mineralogy. The Geological Museum's not far from here, by the way. We'll head there later. 1903, Liu Shan published 2 abridged translations of From Earth to the Moon and Journey to the Center of the Earth by Jules Verne. You know, it's probably the best way for a writer to learn is doing translation of other people's works. You really analyze a work, break it down structurally. Diploma issued by Koban Institute, become aware of choice of words, syntax, everything. Curriculum vitae, Liu Shan. Entrance application form, Liu Shan. 1904, June, enrolled Sendai Medical College. Group photo of Liu Shan and his classmates who resided together with him in this house 10 years later. The house owner imagined
what became of the students and painted mustaches to three of them, including Lu Shan. A letter to introduce Lu Shan to medical college from Qing consulate in Japan. Reply letter and formal acceptance for your tuition and registration fees by the medical school. Oh, wow, I wish I could go to school for free. Houses Lu Zhan resided in when he was in Sendai. Lu Zhan was his classmate for Sendai Medical School in 1904 with his classmates. It's just like the picture Sun Yat-sen took of himself with his medical school classmates in Hong Kong. Lu Shan with Chinese student taken 1903. Mr. Genkoru Fujino, professor of anatomy, Sendai Medical College. Examination results from Lu Zhan's first year in college. Curriculum of the first year of medical studies. New pictures showed that Chinese men were beheaded by Japanese soldiers, while these indifferent compatriots looked on. Lu Shan decided to abandon medical studies and embark on a literary career, photo taken after a farewell party held for him by his classmates in March 1906. A letter Lu Shan wrote to his friend, Jiang Yiji, recounting his life and work in Sendai. A handwritten list of books in German that Lu Shan planned to purchase. Places Lu Zhan lived and visited in Tokyo. 1906, Lu Zhan married Zhu An, native of Shaosheng, by his mother's arrangement. Lu Zhan said later, "This is a gift my mother gave me. I had to accept it and support her. Of love, I know nothing." The fourth day after the marriage, Lu Zhan went back to Japan. Ouch. Zhou Zhu Ren, alias Qi Ming, Lu Zhan's second younger brother, went to Tokyo to study on a government scholarship. Lu Zhan, with others, planned to publish the magazine Vita Nova, New Life, but it failed. This is a picture of the cover design using the painting Hope by G.F. Watts and the square paper for making drafts they prepared for the magazine. Lu Zhan, with others, attended some of Zhang Taiyan's lectures on Chinese philology. Philosophy, or logic, philosophy and logic. These are the class notes taken by Lu Shan. Some pictures, 1906. Zhang Taiyan was in Japan in charge of editing the newspaper Minban, the organ of the Revolutionary Alliance, Tongmen Hui. Zhang was also one of the founders of the Restoration Society, Guangfu Hui, or Hui. Qin Jin, who hailed from city of Shaoxing, anti-Qing revolutionist, beheaded by Qing government after the failed uprising. Tao Cheng Zhang, famous anti-Qing revolutionary activist. Xu Xilin, who hailed from the city of Shaoxing, was an anti-Qing revolutionist killed by the Qing government after a failed uprising. E.H. Haeckel, German biologist. On imbalanced cultural development introduced the idea of Western thinkers such as Stirner, Schopenhauer, Nietzsche. On lessons of the history of science introduced the theories of Bacon and Descartes. Liu Zhan with others attended some of Zhang Taiyan's lectures, Chinese philosophy, or that. On the History of Man, an essay written by Lu Zhan explaining the theories of German biologist E.H. Haeckel, author of Welträtsel, The Riddle of the Universe. It's a riddle of the universe. It's a riddle. It's a mystery. It's from Jewish mysticism. Henrik Ibsen, Norwegian dramatist and poet. Friedrich Nietzsche, German philosopher. Francis Bacon, British philosopher, founder of English materialist philosophy. René Descartes, French philosopher and mathematician. G.G. Byron, British poet. George Gordon, Lord Gordon, George Byron.
Petőfi S., Hungarian poet. A.C. Alexander C. Pushkin, Russian poet. A. Schopenhauer, German philosopher.
Some books in German collected by Liu Jun when he was in Japan. Power of Mara Poetry was published in installments in Henan, 1908. The article praised romantic poets of Europe such as Byron, Pushkin, Petőfi, who possessed a militant spirit of revolt. V.M. Garshin, Russian writer, L.N. Andreev, Russian writer, N.V. Gogol, Russian writer, H. Signed Sienkiewicz, Polish writer. A photo taken in Tokyo, Xu Shou Shang and Jiang Yiji. Jiang gave financial support to the Zhou brothers in publishing Takes from Abroad. Ogai Mori, Japanese writer and translator. Soseki Natsumi, Japanese writer. Books in Japanese collected by Liu Shun. Liu Shun with other four Chinese students once lived in the former residence of the Japanese writer Soseki Natsumi, 10 Banchai Street in Hongo, Nishikata. Journal and newspaper clipping kept by Liu Shun. Hangzhou Shaoxing Nanjing, 1909 to 1912. 1909, Liu Shun returned to China because of the financial problem in his home. At first, he taught in Zhejiang Normal School, Hangzhou, and then served as headmaster of Normal School Shaoxing. Although the 1911 revolution brought about the overthrow of the Qing dynasty in 1912, Liu Shun was deeply disappointed by the vicissitudes of local politics and corruption of officials in 1912. Through the recommendation of a friend, he was appointed to the Ministry of Education by the newly established interim government of Republic of China in Nanjing. In August 1909, Liu Shun returned to China. Liu Shun became a teacher of biology in the Zhejiang Normal School in Hangzhou. Group photo of the teachers of the Zhejiang Normal School after the victory won in expelling headmaster Xie, who was an advocate of loyalty to the monarch. Records about specimen collected by Liu Shun, plant specimens collected by Liu Shun and his students in Hangzhou, my favorite city in China. In July 1910, Liu Shun was appointed Dean of Studies in the Shaoxing Prefectural Middle School. This is Liu Shun's office. Photo of Zhou family without Liu Shun. The center of the front row is Liu Shun's mother. The left and right of the back row are Zhou Ren and Jian Ren. The other two women are their Japanese wives. Mimeographed textbooks edited by Liu Shun to be used in the normal school. During this period, Liu Shun began to compile materials on traditional fiction and local history of Shaoxing. These are manuscripts of the two books published later. Maybe these lines on the floor are just pointing the way to an exit in case of an emergency. I used to think they were the way to go through an exhibit, but I think they're just showing you exit in case there was a calamity and you were too dumb to figure out that the door is over there. Manuscript, a hand copied Ling Biao Lu Yi, a book of the Tang Dynasty. Excerpts he made of Shu Fu, Book of Ming Dynasty. Ancient pavilion where Liu Shun once made stone rubbing, a study of the rubbing from an ancient stone written by Liu Shun. Group photo. When the pupils visited the tomb of the Great Yu. After the Wuchang Uprising, which took place in 1911, many provinces claimed independence. This is the map outlining the independent provinces. And it reminds me of a map I saw in the paper as a little kid after the Gulf War, it was after the fall of the Berlin Wall and collapse of Soviet USSR. and like all these little provinces, like hundreds of new countries created instantly. And I remember looking at that, my dad, and asked my dad, like, what the, these are all going to be new countries? He's like, no, they're not going to be new countries. They're just asserting their independence because they want to throw off the shackles. They fucking hated the Soviets so badly, you know. They're just asserting their independence now, make it official. They'll join up to the countries they were before, probably. He's right, pretty much, with some problems in the Balkans. Wang Jianfa, military leader, led his troops into the city of Shaoxing. In his spare time, Liu Sheng continued to collect and annotate ancient books, especially ancient Chinese novels. Kai Yuan Temple, when the revolution of 1911 broke out, Liu Sheng organized an armed team and took to the streets to explain the situation and help calm the people during the disturbances. In 1912, an interim government of the Republic of China was established in Nanjing, with Sun Yat-sen as elected president. Site of the Toksin of Yue, local daily newspaper edited by Liu Jun and others. Forward to the daily newspaper, the Toksin of Yue, written by Liu Jun, using pen name Huang Ji. 1912, Liu Jun wrote a story in classical Chinese titled Remembering the Past, published in Fiction Monthly. Editor's note, Yuan Tai Chiao praised it highly. Shangnan Library, Nanjing, Liu Sheng often came here to read or copy quotations from ancient books. Kai Yuan Pai, Minister of Education for the Republic, on his invitation, Liu Sheng went to Nanjing in February 1912 to take up a post in the Ministry of Education. Ministry of Education, Interim Government, Republic of China. End of 1911, Liu Sheng was appointed headmaster of Shaoxing Normal School by newly established local government. You read all these, right? Kai Yuan Temple, where the revolution, when the revolution of 1911 broke out, Liu Sheng organized an armed team and took to the streets to explain the situation and help calm the people during the disturbances. Sun Yat-sen never really got to do much after that. Spent all that time advocating, raising money for the revolution, and then warlord pushed him out, Yuan Shikai. Tried to set himself up as the next dynasty, create a new dynastic reign for himself. Yuan Shikai did. Liu Sheng was invited to serve in the new Ministry of Education. So this is in Beijing. He lived here, it said in my guidebook, for 12 years. This is saying 14. Or they said a decade, I think. Liu Sheng was invited to serve in the new Ministry of Education under the Republic during this period, aside from official work. Liu Sheng did textual scholarship on ancient works of fiction, edited local historical records of the Shaoxing region. He collected stone rubbings from the Wei, Jin, and Six Dynasties eras. During the literary revolution, the magazine New Youth solicited and published Liu Sheng's first vernacular short story, Madman's Diary, in May 1918. It fiercely lampooned the inhumanity, hypocrisy, and cannibalism of traditional Chinese morality. Here he first used the pen name Liu Sheng. In the following years, Liu Sheng wrote a satirical novella, The True Story of Ah Q, and many other short stories. On March 18, 1926, troops of the warlord government fired on unarmed student protesters, leaving over 200 dead and wounded, including two of Liu Sheng's students. Liu Sheng called the day the blackest day since the founding of the Republic. As a result, he was placed on a wanted list and forced into hiding in French, German, and Japanese-run hospitals throughout the city. Meanwhile, he had fallen in love with Xu Guangping, and in part, out of consideration for the future of this relationship, he left Beijing in August to accept an appointment at the newly founded Xiamen University. Warlord government, huh? That's, Yuan Shikai? No. I think he was dead by then, Yuan Shikai. Somebody else. Let's see. Photo of Liu Sheng with colleagues, Ministry of Education, third from left, last row. Entrance of the Ministry of Education, Liu Sheng was appointed
As the head of the 2nd Division Department, Social Education in charge of affairs in the Library, Museum, Literature, and Arts. Certificate of appointment issued to Lu Shun by Ministry of Education. The Shaosheng Hostel at Nan Banji Lane in southern part of Beijing, where Lu Shun lived for 7 years. A sketchbook of Bushu study in Shaosheng Hostel, where Lu Shun resided, drawn by Xu Zhou Ren, who lived there with him. The Ode to Qing Yun, the national anthem of the Republic of China, in Lu Shun. Lu Shun was part of the drafting committee. In August 1917, at the invitation of Cai Yuanpai, the president of Beijing University, Lu Shun designed a badge for the university. National emblem of the Republic of China, made in August 1912, Lu Shun was part of the designing committee. Synopsis of the emblem of the Republic of China to the State Council, written by Lu Shun, collaboration with colleagues in Ministry of Education. A proposal for promoting aesthetic education, drafted by Lu Shun and published 1913. Ancient coins collected by Lu Shun. Yilan Hall Preparatory Office Establishment, Museum of Chinese History. Started use July 1912. Lu Shun took part in the museum's establishment. That's what they've now merged into the National Museum, Tiananmen Square, I think. 1914, Lu Shun took part in arranging a national exhibition of children's art. This is a photo of the exhibition staff. The third right in the last row is Lu Shun. Bronze mirror and bowl of the Ming Dynasty, donated by Lu Shun to the Museum of Chinese History. Liu Li Chang, a famous quarter selling books, art, objects, stationery, and other cultural items, frequented by Lu Shun. It's still there. Liu Li Chang is off the Dashalan area and is the antique street, antiques, calligraphy, and some jewelry. Antiques has a loose translation in Chinese. Mostly copies. Mud puppet from the Six Dynasties period, sketched by Lu Shun. They're copying, you know, older styles of art, and they call it antiques. A lot of it's kitsch, too. Lu Shun put much effort in setting up the National Library. This is the group photo at the inauguration of the library in 1917. The fifth on the left row, the fifth in the second row is Lu Shun. Buddhist scriptures collected by Lu Shun. Between 1915 and 16, Lu Shun head of the fiction branch of the Society for Popular Education and Research. This is an order he issued. A sketch of the Stone Gate in the ancient Han Dynasty tomb, drawn by Lu Shun. In order to celebrate his mom's birth anniversary, Lu Shun had a Buddhist scripture printed, a catalog of stone rubbings, Han Dynasty, etc. Lu Shun collected stone rubbings in order to study the history of Chinese philology and literature. 1915, Lu Shun spent 22 days in copying the tile rubbings of Qin and Han dynasties, edited by Chen Dun. Manuscripts of copied stone rubbings at ancient tombs. Gallery proofs of the quintessence of stone rubbings. Seals carved for and presented to Lu Shun by his colleague Shen Shijiang. Some paintings to Lu Shun by Chen Shijiang and others. Cultural relics collected by Lu Shun. Looks like a crossbow trigger. Some statues. This is a stone rubbing, it looks like, of a stele. Stone rubbing, dated from Han Dynasty. Catalog of books of stone rubbings and tomb carvings, compiled and edited by Lu Shun. According to Lu Shun's diary, he often went to Liu Li Chang to purchase rubbings. In 1916, he purchased 1,011 pieces of rubbings, which cost $453.38. The works of Ji Kang, a well-known writer from the state of Wei,
State of Wei, I guess it is Wei, State of Wei, in the Three Kingdoms period. From 1913 to 31, Lu Xun edited his works, correcting different editions. Stone rubbing, Lu Xun collection, brick rubbing. 1919, May 4th movement erupted Beijing. The 5-4 movement. This is the New Youth magazine. Editor-in-chief, Shen Duxin. More than 50 articles of the Lu Xun appeared in it between 1918 and 21. Manuscripts of contributions to New Youth copied by the then editor-in-chief, Chen Duxin, and retained by another editor, Qian Xuantong. Some newspapers and magazines published during the May 4th period. My Humble Opinion in Literary Reform, written by Hu Shi, published in issue 5 of volume 2, A New Youth. On Literary Revolution, written by Chen Duxin, published in the issue 6, volume 2, New Youth. My Point of View, Marxism by Li Daxiao, published in issue 5 of volume 6, A New Youth. Literary of the Human Being, written by Literature of the Human Being, written by Jojo Ren, his brother, published in issue 6, volume 5, New Youth. Repercussions of the Literary Revolution, written by Qian Xuantong, published in issue 3 of volume 4 of New Youth. Let's take a break and look at this model of Shaoxing Hostel, west room of Tenghua House, in which Lu Xun lived, May 1912 to April 1916. Busy study in which Lu Xun lived May 16th to November 1919, where he wrote Diary of a Madman, Kong Yi Ji, Medicine, etc., Big Pagoda Tree, described in the preface of Call to Arms. Those are the 1, 2, 3 points they're pointing out. So he lived here, here, and this is his tree. There's some pictures I didn't look at up here. Editorial office, New Youth, also known as Chen Duxin's residence. Reports of October Revolution of Russian Chinese newspapers and magazines. Chen Duxin, professor at Beijing University, later became the founder of the Chinese Communist Party. Lu Xun said of him, he was one of the most persistent among those who urged me to write fiction. Li Daxiao, one of the founders of the Chinese Communist Party, editor of New Youth, Lu Xun, stated that Li's works were a legacy left to us by foreigner and a monument in the history of the revolution. I don't know if any of these guys are the ones I saw over at the Honglu Library there, part of Peking University near the National Art Museum. Hu Shi, professor at Beijing University, editor of New Youth, proponent of literary reform. Lu Xun's younger brother, Zhou Juren, invited on Lu Xun's recommendation to the then Chancellor Kai Yuan Pai to teach Beijing University, wrote many articles on literary theory and continued to translate foreign works in collaboration with Lu Xun. Qian Xuantong, another editor with New Youth, urged Lu Xun to write articles for the magazine. Liu Bannang, a professor at Beijing University and contributed to New Youth, Lu Xun called him a fighter on the front of literary revolution who fought quite a few big battles. Reply to Wang Jingxuan, written by Liu Bannang, published issue 3, volume 4, New Youth. So you can see the association of the youth with the counterculture revolution of the 20th century. First, it's the Soviets and socialists, really, rising up against, you know, the Tsar and the Emperor, and then the World Wars, and you have, like, in the United States, counterculture youth movements, yippies and hippies and all that. They have... The downside of this is the Cultural Revolution and
50s, 60s, 70s. Guess really 60s, 70s. We were having our hippie revolution of the youth, cultural revolution. And in China, they were having the cultural revolution, the Red Guard and the youth and all that, little red books, magazines and articles opposing the new culture movement. It is the new culture movement that is over at the museum there that I'm talking about. Vernacular poem written by Liu Shun, published in New Youth. Some of Liu Shun's polemic essays published in New Youth. Madman's Diary, first short story written vernacular, modern Chinese literature, published issue 5, volume 4, New Youth. In this story, Zhou Shuren firstly used the pen name Liu Shun. Madman's Diary. Just some photos there. The story of Ah Q. What did I call it earlier? The story of O. Sun Fu Yuan, one of Liu Zhang's pupils at Shaoxing Prefectural School, then editor-in-chief of the Supplement to the Morning Post. Supplement to the Morning Post. Model of the Badawan residence. Let's see, number one, back here. Room where Liu Zhang wrote the true story of Ah Q. Number two, here, little pond in which Aeroshenko kept tadpoles as described in Liu Zhang's short story, Comedy of Ducks. Three, back here, room in which Zhou Shuren lived. Hu Shi, in his Chinese literature for over the last 50 years, praised Liu Shan's literary works highly. Shen Yan Bing, pen name Mao Dun, writer and key member with Literary Research Society. I went to Mao Dun's house. It's over off Nanlu Gu. They have a little memorial museum to him. No, maybe Mao Dun's house was in a different location. I think it was. I think it was that one. Front cover of Call to Arms, designed by Liu Shun himself. And a poem he wrote on a copy of the book 10 years after its publication. A copy of the first Chinese version of the Manifesto of the Communist Party, published in 1920, presented to Liu Shun by the translator in 1920. Magazine edited by Creation Society, literary group established 1921, preaching art for art's sake. August 1923 saw the publication of the first collection of Liu Shan's short stories called Call to Arms. Front cover of Call to Arms, designed by Liu Shan himself, poem he wrote in the copy of the book 10 years after its publication. Liu Shun supported the Esperanto movement. This is a group photo of members of the Esperanto Society of Beijing taken in May 1922. Liu Shun served from right in the front row. That's where they tried to take all the case, just one case of Latin, and make a new language. That was real simple and logical. But since nobody spoke it, it never took off. Aeroshenko, blind Russian poet and scholar of Esperanto, stayed in Liu Zhang's house, 1921, Liu Zhang translated some of his works. This is a group photo taken April 15, 1923. Aeroshenko, his second right, and Liu Zhang's second left, front row. Fiction Monthly, a journal of the Literary Research Society, which advocated art for life, devoted to the introduction of the literature of the Oppressed Nations. Shen Yan Bin, then editor-in-chief of Fiction Monthly, often correspondent with Liu Shun. August 2nd, 1923, Liu Shan moved out of the Zhou family compound at Batawan due to the worsening relations with Zhou Zhuren into a rented house at number 61, Xuananta Lane. So he had problems with his brother. North room, Liu Zhen lived at number 61, Xuananta Lane. Parts of Liu Zhen's translations published in Beijing period, some of them were done in collaboration with Zhou Ren and others. Number 21, West 3rd Lane, Gongmenku, Fucheng Menai, Beijing. Literary magazine that printed some of his short stories, later included in Wandering. The combined study and bedroom, which came to be called Tiger's Tail. Drawing of the layout, Liu Zhen's residence, West 3rd Lane, Fucheng Menai, designed himself. Liu Zhen's letters of appointment as part-time teacher at several colleges and schools in Beijing. We're on Fucheng Menai now. This was his house, huh? National Beijing University, where Liu Zhen taught. Beijing Normal University, where he also taught. Received for salary received by Liu Zhen from Beijing University. Group photo taken in the inaugural ceremony of the Xi'an Summer School, 11th right. And second row is Liu Zhen. Zhang King Qian, a friend of Liu Zhen, took part in the publication of the weekly Tatler. This is a copy of the brief history of Chinese fiction presented to him by Liu Zhen with a humorous inscription. Plaque Liu Zhen and other scholars presented to Yi Su He, local opera group. Historical evolution of Chinese fiction published from Liu Zhen's lectures at a summer school in Xi'an, 1924. Poems in experimental collection by Hu Shi, presented to Liu Zhen. Hu Shi wrote a letter to Liu Zhen asking the latter to comment on his poems in an experimental collection in vernacular Chinese, the first of its kind in modern history, modern Chinese literary history. This is Liu Zhen's reply, suggesting several poems be deleted. Liu Zhen helped young people organize literary associations and societies such as the Sunken Bell Society and the Unnamed Society. The photo is of members of the Unnamed Society. These are newspapers and magazines either edited by or published under the mentorship of Liu Zhen. Wilderness and Sunken Bell, two literary magazines published under the guidance of Liu Zhen. Some literary works written by young writers published with the help of Liu Zhen. Charcoal Sketch of Liu Zhen by Tao Yong Yuan Qing, 1926, a favorite of Liu Zhen. First edition of Wild Grass, collection of prose poems in which Liu Zhen expressed complex emotions against a sometimes uncanny and surrealistic backdrop. Tatler's, a weekly magazine in which most pieces of Wild Grass were printed. Folder to hold teaching materials used by Liu Zhen. Five Policemen and 1-0, a painting by Situ Chiao, dating New Year's Eve, 1925. The O represents woman beaten by five policemen. Liu Zhen bought this painting and hung it on the east wall of his study. Brush and pen and ink slab used by Liu Zhen Beijing. Some of his clothes. Liu Zhen fully supported the students of Beijing Women's Normal College and opposing educational bureaucrats. This is the manifesto concerning the struggle of the Beijing Women's Normal College he and other professors co-authored. The Beijing Women's Normal College, where Liu Zhen taught between July 1923 and November 1925. After the government took over the Women's Normal College, students hired rooms in Zhang Mao Lane, where Liu Zhen still went to teach free of charge. Xu Guangping's first letter sent to Liu Shan dated March 11, 1925. Liu Shan's immediate reply to Xu Guangping dated March 11, 1925. Modern Critics Weekly magazine, which criticized Liu Shan for his involvement in the struggle. Some polemic essays Liu Shan wrote debating them with members of Modern Critics School, later collected into Grave, Bad Luck, and Bad Luck 2. Group photo of teachers and students taken January 13, 1926, after they won the movement. Left 6 of the first row is Liu Shan. Xu Guangping was a student in the Department of Chinese Language at Beijing Women's Normal College by October 1925. Xu and Liu Shan had fallen in love. Students at Beijing Women's Normal College began a protest against the school's conservative president, Yang Yinyu, who was backed by Shang Shijiao, Minister of Education. This is a record of the event. Fellow Travelers, an essay written by Xu Guangping to express her love for Liu Shan. Wind is My Love, an essay written by Xu Guangping under the pen name Ping Lin to express her love for Liu Shan. A petition for the dismissal of Yang Yinyu, written by the students of Beijing Women's Normal College under the guidance of Liu Shan. In 1925, the May 30th incident took place in Shanghai, in which colonial police fired on a crowd of protesters. This led to a patriotic anti-imperialist of strikes and boycotts across the country. Liu Hijian and Yang Dichun, two students with Beijing Women's Normal College, were killed by military soldiers in March 18th massacre. Memorial Hall at Beijing University, where a meeting was held to mourn Liu Hijian and Yang Dichun. May 25th in Shanghai. They mentioned this at the museum was I at. Striking workers. More Roses Without Blooms 2 by Liu Shan. Amid pale bloodstains and other pieces Liu Shan wrote after the March 18th massacre in memory of Miss Liu Liao Liu Hejin. Liu Shan contributed an inscription to the memorial book of May 30th massacre, compiled by Beijing Normal University. The grave, a collection of essays Liu Shan wrote from 1907 to 25. Hot Air, the first collection of essays Liu Shan wrote from 1918 to 24. I think there was like a Japanese foreman who beat a Chinese worker, and he wasn't punished by whoever owned the factory, the British or something. And then there was big protests or something, led to violence. Couple big protests. Bad Luck, collection of 31 essays Liu Shan wrote 1925. More Bad Luck, collection of 33 essays Liu Shan wrote 1926 and 27. Liu Shan's essays on deferring fair play, in which he criticized such ideas as don't take vengeance, don't oppose evil with evil. Instead, he facetiously advocated the principle of beating a vicious dog if it falls into the water. Liu Shan won the case. This is the appeals office letter of education. Lin Yu Tang drew a cartoon filled Mr. Liu Shan is beating a pug. After coming around to agreement with Liu Shan's position in the 1926 debate on deferring fair play, Liu Shan went into hiding in several hospitals run by French, German, Japanese. Liu Shan took his case to the Office of Appeals, an organization handling lawsuits concerning administrative affairs, and brought suit against Zhang Shijiao, Minister of Education. Zhang Shijiao, Minister of Education under warlord regime, and dismissed Liu Shan from his post because of his support for the student movement. So that's what happened. A bamboo basket Liu Shan used while he was in flight. Warlord government ordered more arrests, and Liu Shan's name was on the blacklist.
And there's more of the exhibit downstairs. I'll have to make a new video. Brief history of Chinese fiction from early 1920s to 30s. Lu Zhen revised and improved this work many times.